Penguin Random House Audio presents Viola in the Spotlight by Adriana Trigiani. Read for you by Carlotta Brentan. For my beloved librarians, Billie Jean Scott, James Varner, and in memory of Ernestine Roller. Chapter 1. There is no better place on earth than right here on my stoop on 72nd Street in Bay Ridge, borough of Brooklyn, city of New York, county of Kings, the Empire State. Home. I lift my video camera, flip to record, and peer through the lens, taking in every familiar detail of our cul-de-sac. That's French for dead end. Dad and Mom picked me up at the Prefect Academy in South Bend, Indiana, yesterday morning. After we loaded up the car, I said goodbye to my roommates. Suzanne took pictures of us with her phone. Casual observation, beautiful blondes like Suzanne are as comfortable behind the camera taking pictures as they are in front of it. Romy, who we are so proud of, because out of the four of us, she has the most athletic ability and made the field hockey team champions, gave me a goodbye gift, a set of Twilight books, and her favorite Lauren Conrad novel, L.A. Candy. Again, an unofficial poll, but jocks at Prefect read a lot. They have to have something to pass the time when they're in the gym on the elliptical. Marisol was so sad that she cried and swore she'd miss me the most. We got to be very close friends. Marisol may be the most sensitive girl on the planet, and she is also a true blue friend. We created our own friendship crest, a puffy heart with a pair of Lady Gaga sequin-studded sunglasses in the center. In a ribbon underneath, Veritas Forevertas, La Chica Amica e Bono. Or, Forever True, Girlfriends and Goodness. The four of us had been there for one another the entire school year, so we fell into familiar patterns, like four sisters, even in our goodbyes. Suzanne joked around and cheered Marisol up, while Romy reassured her that we would all stay in touch no matter what. We made plans to stay in constant communication by texting, calling, and of course by Skype and by email. We will remain close in cyberspace. My roommates made my ninth grade year at the Prefect Academy as good as it could possibly be, but I'm not going back next year. It's time to be a New Yorker again, attend LaGuardia High School, and reunite with my old friends. I did well on my admissions testing, thank you, Prefect Prep Class, and Mom and Dad made sure that my application was turned in so that I'd be accepted. My short movie that placed in the Midwest competition sealed the deal. The film faculty thought it was pretty good. Of course, I will miss the big events at Prefect, including the dorm parties, the hayrides, and the film competition. But it's the little things I will treasure when I think of my roommates. I'll never forget the blue streaks in Romy's red hair, which grew out inch by inch until the blue was just a fringe on the bottom like a dust ruffle on a bed. I never had to use an alarm clock, because every morning when Marisol weighed herself, the scale blurted out the number and woke me up. I'll miss Suzanne's ability to center part her hair without having to look in the mirror. It was a feat that amazed me until the last day of school. There was also a lot of natural beauty to savor in South Bend, Indiana, once I decided it wouldn't kill me to like another place almost as much as New York City. The Midwest can be mysterious and grand. I'll never forget the slow curves of the St. Joe River, the twilight sky that turned from electric blue to purple as the sun set, and the snow, so heavy and persistent that it altered the landscape, making mountains of white drifts on the flat cornfields. Mom, Dad, and I decided to drive through the night instead of stopping in a motel somewhere in Pennsylvania to break up our trip. We wanted to be together again, just the three of us, in the cocoon of our car on the long highway home. Our family is like a small machine that can't run properly when one of the parts is missing. It turns out that they wanted to get home to Brooklyn as much as I did. A year in Afghanistan made them appreciate everything about our lives in the Chesterton family, including our car and the smooth highways that connect everything. Dad took my mom's hand in the front seat a lot when he was driving. We made it back by 2 a.m., and I wasn't one bit tired. This is my first official installment of the Viola Reels, which I am calling the Return Reels, as this is my triumphant return to the place I love most in the world, New York, in the season I love best, summer, on the harbor that I adore. My river flows with the waters of creative baptism. By the way, I heard the term creative baptism last night for the first time on an all-night radio show my dad was listening to as we drove through Ohio. Mom was asleep, and Dad was listening to Prince, his favorite, and Taylor Swift, mine. We got tired of both, and Dad turned on the old-fashioned radio. That's when he heard a preacher giving a sermon and became entranced with the minister's cadence. I did too, as the preacher spoke of the healing power of water. I immediately thought of the harbor, and then extended my new belief system to be grateful for all the things I treasure about city life, including Andrew Bozelli, BFFAA, Caitlin Pullapilly, we have to work around her strict parents, but she's worth it, Serendipity Frozen Hot Chocolate, the E-Train, Tag Nachmanoff, 8th Street in Greenwich Village, the Angel Tree at the Metropolitan Museum of Art at Christmas time, the Broadway line of the M4 bus, Original Ray's Pizza by the Slice. I could probably double this list, but that's not the big news. The headline for today, June 15, 2010, I am finally, completely, and decidedly home. I take a slow pan of our building, drinking in the delicate details that I did not for a single moment forget when I was in boarding school. I shoot the expanse of the lacy wrought iron fence that separates our stoop from the neighbors, the old blue urn with cracks that look like spider webs in the glaze, and finally, the brass mail slot with a Greek key design around the edges. I lift the camera to frame the shot with green, leafy branches that bend gently over our stoop. I widen out to take in the expanse of our street. Brownstone buildings, just like ours, from the 1800s, line either side of my block, shaded by old Norway maple trees that form a summery satin canopy over the old macadam. The sidewalk curbs are staggered with seams of bright yellow paint to define parking spots. Parking spots cannot be reserved by just anyone. The tenants on our block know that the space in front of their homes officially belongs to them. We actually chase off people who try to park here who do not live on our street. We reserve the spaces as seriously as the guards who protect the money bags on the Brinks truck. I angle in on the old fire hydrant, once painted in bold stripes of bright red, white, and green in honor of the Italian flag. Now, after years of sun and wear, the hydrant has faded to a dull pink, gray, and mint green. I asked Mom if we could repaint it, and she said, "Let's not. It's symbolic of a bygone era." She's right. These are monuments, after all. Brooklyn monuments. We live in history. Dad says we are caretakers of this old building, and if we keep it in good condition, another family will enjoy it when we have moved on. Hopefully never. The Martinelli family sold our brownstone to my parents 8 years ago. They were genuine Italians. We kept the grape arbor and olive trees they planted in the backyard. Our basement smells like a wine bottle, because they used to store crates of grapes there to make wine. In winter, when we build fires, the scent of the Martinelli's homemade wine still wafts through the house, smoky and cold and woodsy, like the wooden barrels they stored it in. Last night, When we arrived and dropped my suitcases and stuff in the front entry, I ran.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.